Brothers and sisters, what a turnout. Thank you so much for being here. It doesn't seem true, but we began this campaign about 3.5 months ago, and the momentum has been unbelievable. We have had huge turnouts in Burlington, Vermont, in Denver, in Minneapolis, in Madison, in Phoenix, in Portland, Maine, in New Orleans. But I want to tell you something tonight. We got 12,000 people here, 3,000. And a few minutes ago, I just said hello to 3,000 people outside. So thank you. You know, the media asked me, they say, well, what's going on? Why do so many people come out? Why do you have more individual campaign contributors than any other campaign? Why last week did we have 3,700 organizational meetings all across this country, 100,000 people? And the answer is pretty simple. The answer for why people are rising up is that all across this country, people are sick and tired of establishment politics, establishment economics, and they want real change. The people of America understand that corporate greed is destroying our country, that American politics is now dominated by big money interests, and that much of the mainstream media is prepared to talk about everything except that is what is most important. And the other point that I want to make in opening is to tell you that this campaign differs from any other campaign, because I will be very honest with you and tell you what few tell you. And that is, no president can do it alone. No one person in the White House can take on Wall Street, corporate America. We need to do it together. We need a grassroots political movement from the West to the East, which tells the big money interest, this country, our government, belong to all of us, not just a handful. Let me just say a brief word now, because you've heard a lot from the people who came before me about institutional racism and criminal justice reform. Let me be very brief and say this. As somebody who has one of the strongest lifetime civil rights records in the United States Congress, no president will fight harder to end the stain of racism in this country and reform our criminal justice system, period. Brothers and sisters, today we are living in the wealthiest country in the history of the world. But almost nobody knows that, because almost all of the wealth rest in the hands of the few. The United States now has more income and wealth inequality than any major country on earth, and it is worse today than at any time since 1928. The issue of wealth and income inequality is the great moral issue of our time. It is the great political issue of our time. It is the great economic issue of our time. And together, we will address it. There is something profoundly wrong when the top one-tenth of 1% owns almost as much wealth as the bottom 90%. There is something profoundly wrong when 58% of all new income goes to the top 1%. There is something profoundly wrong when we have seen in recent years a proliferation of millionaires and billionaires, while the average American works longer hours for lower wages, and we have the highest rate of childhood poverty of any major country. That is wrong. That is unacceptable. That will change. We need an economy that works for working families and the middle class, not just a handful of billionaires. This campaign is sending a message to the billionaire class. And that message is simple and straightforward. You cannot have it all. You cannot get huge tax breaks when children in America go hungry. You cannot continue to send our jobs abroad when millions of Americans are in desperate need of work right here. You cannot hide your profits in the Cayman Islands and Bermuda. You will pay your fair share of taxes. The billionaire class cannot take advantage of all of the benefits of America if they do not accept their responsibilities as Americans. But the economic crisis that we face is not just the grotesque level of income and wealth inequality. We've got to be honest and understand that for the last 40 years, the great middle class of this nation, once the envy of the entire world, that great middle class is disappearing. Despite exploding technology and increased worker productivity, median family income is almost $5,000 less today than it was in 1999. In my state of Vermont, in your state of Washington, people are working not one job, they're working two jobs, they're working three jobs, trying to cobble together some income and some health care. That is not an American economy. We can and must do much better than that. And when we talk about the economy and what's happening to working families, it is important for you to understand that real unemployment is not the 5.3% which the newspapers report. That's official unemployment. Real unemployment includes those people who have given up looking for work and the millions of people who are working part-time when they want to work full-time. When you add that together, real unemployment in America is almost 10.5%. And here is something else that almost nobody discusses, but it is a huge, huge issue. You know, one of the fun things about running for president is you can raise issues that other people choose not to talk about. And let me talk about one issue, and that is that today we have a horrendous tragedy in terms of youth unemployment in America. Last month, I asked the Economic Policy Institute to do a study for us, and what they found is that for kids who graduated high school between the age of 17 and 20, if they were white, real unemployment and underemployment was 33%. If they were Hispanic, real unemployment was 36%. If they were African American, real unemployment is 51%. Now, there is no excuse for the United States of America having more people in jail than any other country on earth, more than China. This is a failure of our criminal justice system, a failure of our educational system, and a failure of our economy. But I will tell you this. It makes more sense to me to be investing in jobs and education for our kids than in jails and incarceration. I do not want the United States to continue to have the ugly distinction of having more people in jail. I want the United States to have the proud distinction of having the best educated population on earth. Too many lives have been destroyed by the so-called war on drugs. Too many lives have been destroyed by incarceration. We need to educate, we need to put people to work. And when we talk about the economy, it is also important to put on the table that tens of millions of our people are working today at totally inadequate low wages. The current federal minimum wage of $7.25 an hour is a starvation wage and must be raised. Let me congratulate the people of Seattle, your city council, and all those who stood up and said that we need a living wage for workers, $15 an hour. You did it in Seattle. We are now going to do it for the entire country. The simple truth is, not a radical idea, is that no person who works 40 hours a week should be living in poverty. And when we talk about fair wages, I want every man in this room to stand with the women of this country, demand pay equity for women workers. All right, guys, you're going to stand with the women, right? All right. Further, you know, many Republicans talk about family values. You've heard them talking about family values? You just heard them the other night in their debate. They just love families. Well, I've got four kids. I've got seven beautiful grandchildren. My wife and I have been married for 27 years. We believe in family. But our view of family values is just a little bit different. Now, when the Republicans talk about family values, let's be clear about what they're talking about. They believe that women in America should not have the right to control their own bodies. I disagree. They believe that women in America should not have the right to buy the contraceptives they need. I disagree. They believe that our gay brothers and sisters should not have the right to get married and enjoy all of the benefits of being Americans. I disagree. So let me tell you briefly my view of family values. And that is that the United States must end the international embarrassment of being the only major country on earth, the only one, which does not guarantee workers paid medical and family leave. Now, let me tell you about real family values, and that is that today in the state of Washington, in the state of Vermont, a woman is having a baby. It is an extraordinary day for that woman, for her family, and a pretty big day for the baby as well. But here's the point. Here is the point. If that woman, if that family has sufficient income, that mom and the dad will be able to stay home for weeks and months, getting to know and love their baby, getting to bond with their baby. Something, for those of you who have kids know, is the most extraordinary moments of our lives. But if that mom does not have sufficient income, she will be forced to go back to work in 3 days, 5 days, 8 days. She will be separated from that baby she just bore. Separating a mom from her baby because she does not have sufficient income to stay home is not a family value. It is the opposite of a family value. That is why I will fight for 12 weeks of paid family leave. And that is why the United States must also join the rest of the industrialized world in understanding a few points. And that is that in our country today, you may know this, you may not know this, but because of the collapse of our middle class, the people of America work longer hours than do the people of any other country. And yet, despite the fact that 85% of men are working more than 40 hours, 65% of women are working more than 40 hours, there are jobs that are being offered today that provide zero, none, paid vacation time. And that is why I will fight for 10 days paid vacation time for every worker in America. And furthermore, we should not be the only major country on earth not guaranteeing sick time for our working people. When we talk about the economy and when pollsters go out and they call you up and they say, what is uppermost on your mind? What do you feel most strongly about? Invariably, what the American people say is a four-letter word, J-O-B-S. People understand how fragile the economy is. They understand that if you're 55, you can be replaced tomorrow by somebody half your age at half the wages. They understand that if you're young, how hard it is to get a job, especially a job equivalent to your education. So the truth is, the federal government needs to develop a massive federal jobs program to put our people back to work. All over this country, our infrastructure, our roads, bridges, rail, airports, wastewater plants, water plants, levees, and dams are crumbling. We used to have the best infrastructure in the world. Now we are far below many other countries. Let us invest, and I've put forward legislation, $1 trillion over 5 years, rebuild our infrastructure, create up to 13 million good-paying jobs. Think of an America where people are building and repairing our rail system, our airports, our levees, our dams, improving our bridges, improving our roads. We can make America safer, more efficient, more productive. Let's do it. And when we talk about jobs, it's not only the need to create millions of decent-paying jobs, it is the need to stop the loss of jobs because of our disastrous trade policies. You are looking at a senator and a former congressman who voted against NAFTA, against CAFTA, against permanent normal trade relations with China. And you're looking at a senator who will do everything he can to defeat this disastrous TPP. We need an approach to trade which works for working families, not just the CEOs of large corporations. And when we use such words as greed, recklessness, illegal behavior, arrogance, these are just some of the words to describe Wall Street. We bailed out Wall Street because they destroyed the American economy and because they were, quote unquote, too big to fail. Today, most of the major banks are bigger now than they were when we bailed them out because they were too big to fail. So my view is pretty simple. If a bank is too big to fail, it's too big to exist. We got to break them up. We need a financial system that is part of the economy, that makes affordable loans to small and medium-sized businesses, that helps us create jobs, helps people buy homes, not charge us outrageous interest rates on our credit cards, not be an island unto itself whose only goal is to make outlandish profits. Let's break them up. My friends, let me be as blunt and straightforward in telling, if I haven't been already, in telling you what I think most of you already know. And that is, as a result of the disastrous Supreme Court decision in the Citizens United case, the American political system has been totally corrupted. Corrupted. And make no mistake about it, the foundations of American democracy are being undermined. What the Supreme Court said to the wealthiest people in this country, it said, all right, guys, you already own much of the economy. Now we're going to let you buy the United States government, and that is exactly what they are trying to do. We have a situation where one family, the extreme right-wing Koch family, a family that believes in ending Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, the Environmental Protection Agency, the U.S. Postal Service. That's their agenda. That one family, will spend almost $1 billion on this campaign to elect candidates who represent the rich and the powerful. When one family can spend and is spending more money than either the Democratic Party or the Republican Party, brothers and sisters, that is not called democracy. That is called oligarchy. And that is why we have got to overturn Citizens United. I have not made many promises during this campaign, but let me repeat one promise that I have made. And that is, any nominee of mine to the U.S. Supreme Court will, in fact, have to pass a litmus test. And that litmus test is that he or she will vote as soon as possible to overturn Citizens United. I am the former chairman of the Senate Veterans Committee, and I've talked to countless veterans who have put their lives on the line to defend this country and to defend democracy. And we cannot allow the billionaire class to destroy American democracy. We've got to stand up and make it crystal clear that not only will we overturn Citizens United, we're going to move toward public funding of elections. I believe in my heart of hearts, I am a huge believer in democracy. I love democracy. I love the idea that everybody can participate in the political process. I love the idea that we can and should have serious debates and respect people's differences of opinion. I love the idea that anybody can run for office. But unless we move to public funding of elections, young people will continue to have to beg campaign funds from the rich and the powerful. That I want to see end. I want to see people here tonight and others, regardless of their political views, conservatives, moderates, progressives, I want to see people say, you know what? I have a set of ideas. This is what I believe for my state, for my country. I'm going to run for office based on my ideas, not based on the amount of money I collect from billionaires. The other day, a few days ago, in D.C., I was at a meeting, at a function, at an event with Martin Luther King III and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, a major civil rights group. And they were there to honor and acknowledge the 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act in this country, a huge step forward. But they were also there, and I was also there, to say loudly and clearly that the Supreme Court's gutting of the Civil Rights Act 2 years ago is unacceptable. If you can believe it, and how sad this is, literally hours after the Supreme Court ruled, you had states going to work, trying to pass legislation, making it harder for people of color, poor people, and older people to vote. How disgraceful. Now, I'm a politician, and I run for office. Sometimes I win, and sometimes I lose. But it has never, ever occurred to me to figure out a way to keep people from voting because they disagreed with me. And let me say as clearly as I can, those people who are trying to keep their fellow Americans from voting, coming up with these phony voter fraud concerns, those people are political cowards who don't have the guts to defend their ideas. If you're in politics, tell people why you think they should vote for you. Don't try to prevent others from participating in the democracy. Today in America, all of you know, we are living in a highly competitive global economy. And if we are going to succeed, we need the best educated workforce in the world. It is absolutely absurd that today in America, in the year 2015, hundreds of thousands of bright, qualified young people cannot go to college simply because their families lack the income. And that is why I have introduced legislation that does a couple of fairly revolutionary things. Number one, it says that in the United States of America, every public college and university will be tuition free. And I'll tell you why this is such an important idea. It's not just obviously that it'll make life easier financially for those who are going to college, but it does something much more. Right now in Seattle, in Burlington, Vermont, all across this country, there are kids who are in the fourth grade who are in the sixth grade. Their parents didn't go to college. Their friends' parents didn't go to college. They don't know anybody who went to college. And the idea of going to college is something outside of their worldview. But what we will say to those kids now is if you study hard, if you take school seriously, you will in fact be able to go to college regardless of the income of your family. And when we talk about higher education financing, we also have to talk about the absurdity of millions of young and not so young Americans saddled with oppressive student debt. Last year in Vermont, met with a group of people. Young woman whose crime in life was she wanted to go to medical school, she did. She wanted to practice primary care with low-income people, that's what she's doing. Exactly the kind of doctors we need. She left school $300,000 in debt. Talk to a young woman in Iowa. She went to dental school. We have a dental crisis in America. We need more dentists. She left dental school $400,000 in debt. And millions of others leaving college $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 in debt. Now, what sense is it that people today with student debt are paying 6, 8, 10% interest rates on that debt when you can refinance your home for 2 or 3%? Legislation that I've offered will allow people to significantly lower their interest rates on student debt by refinancing. And furthermore, we're going to get the government out of profiteering on student debt. It makes no sense that you have people working today paying 20 or 25% of their income, paying it back on their student loans. They can't get a home. They can't get married. That's wrong, and we're going to change that. When we talk about our responsibilities as human beings and as parents, there is nothing more important than leaving this planet healthy and habitable for our kids and our grandchildren. The debate is over. Now, it's not over on Fox TV. They forgot to talk about it the other day. Scientific community tells us that climate change is the great global crisis we face. Scientific community tells us climate change is real. It's caused by human activity. It is already causing devastating problems in our country and throughout the world. And what the scientists tell us is that we have a reasonably short window of opportunity to prevent horrendous things from happening to this planet. What they say, and I'm on the Environmental Committee and the Energy Committee, what the scientists tell us, if we don't get our act together, this planet Earth will become 5 to 10 degrees warmer by the end of the century. More droughts, more flood, more extreme weather disturbances, more rising sea levels, more acidification of the ocean. And what the CIA tells us, climate change will result in more international conflict as people fight for scarce water and land resources. We have a moral responsibility to lead the world, to work with China and Russia and India, to lead the world in transforming our energy system away from fossil fuel. And into energy efficiency and sustainable energies like wind, solar, geothermal, and others. Now, the truth is, you know, as perhaps the most progressive member of the Senate, I have strong disagreements with my Republican colleagues on a whole host of issues. That goes without saying. But, on this issue, what we are seeing is not a disagreement. We are seeing an international embarrassment when you have a major political party denying the reality of what science is telling us. And I say to my Republican colleagues, I understand that your party is heavily funded by the Koch brothers and their fossil fuel machine. I understand you're funded by ExxonMobil and the coal companies. And I understand that if you listen to science, they may cut your funding. But I say this to my Republican colleagues. Have the courage and the decency to listen to your kids and your grandchildren, not your campaign donors. We talk about the needs of the United States, of working people in the United States. We should all be embarrassed that we remain the only major country on Earth that does not guarantee all of our people health care as a right. I live in Burlington, Vermont, 100 miles away from Canada. They've got a national health care system. Germany has a health care system. The UK has a national health care system. Scandinavia has a national health care system. And the United States of America must have a single-payer Medicare for all single-payer system. When we talk about our priorities as a nation, let me just tell you a little bit about where my Republican colleagues are coming from. I am the ranking member, the leader of the opposition on the Democratic side on the important budget committee. Several months ago, the Republicans control the House and the Senate. They passed their budget. Media didn't report about it very much. But I want to tell you what was in that budget. What the Republicans did was throw in their budget, recommended to the Appropriations Committees, that they end the Affordable Care Act, cut Medicaid by over $400 billion, which meant, and no one denies this, 27 million Americans would be thrown off of health insurance. And when you ask them, as I did, tell me, when you throw 27 million people off of health insurance, how many of them will die? How many of them will end up much sicker than they otherwise would have been? And you know what their answer is? No answer at all. They don't care. And in their budget, over a 10-year period, when millions of families are struggling to figure out how they're going to send their kids to college, they cut the Pell Grant program by $90 billion. And when millions of families are struggling to put food on the table, when half of the kids in public schools in America get free lunch or reduced lunch because their families lack the money, Republicans made massive cuts in nutrition programs, including the WIC program, which provides nutrition to low-income pregnant women. And then, to give you an idea of their priorities, to add insult to injury, they proceeded to provide over $250 billion in tax breaks to the richest 0.2%. That is not a set of priorities that is moral or a set of priorities that the American people want. Brothers and sisters, what this campaign is about is to bring people together who have a very different set of priorities than Republican priorities. And to do that, we are going to have to build a strong grassroots movement and reach out to people who don't necessarily agree with us on every issue. My guess is that here in Washington, most working-class Republicans do not believe that we should be giving huge tax breaks for billionaires and cutting Social Security and Medicare. Our job is to reach out to those Republicans. Our job is to reach out to young people who don't understand the significance of politics for their lives. Our job is to bring people together. We have got to end the divisions in this country between gays and straights. Between black and white. And we have got to also understand that when we bring people together, we cannot forget that there are 11 million people in this country who are living in the shadows. We've got to bring them out of the shadows. We must be about bringing families together, not dividing them. We need comprehensive immigration reform and a path toward citizenship. Yesterday, I had a conversation with the president about the situation in Iran. We chatted for a while. And what I get very nervous about is that apparently many of my Republican colleagues and Republican candidates for president have forgotten the lessons of the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. They forgot the real cost of war. Not just 6,700 brave Americans who died in Afghanistan and Iraq, but 500,000 who came home with PTSD and traumatic brain injury. And if this country means anything, we must make certain that every veteran gets the health care and all the benefits that they're entitled to. And in terms of Iran, this is what I believe. I believe that a great nation must do everything that it can to resolve international conflict, even with people we have strong disagreements with, rather than going to war. I voted against the war in Iraq because I had a sense of the kind of destabilization it would bring about. I want to give peace every chance, every opportunity. So I am going to work with the president on his agreement in making certain that Iran does not get a nuclear weapon, but we can do that without going to war. Let me conclude by just saying this. I hope very much that the thousands of people here tonight are prepared to think big, not small. I hope you are prepared to imagine the kind of country we can create when government works for all of us and not just a few. We can live in a country where health care is a right for all people. We can live in a country in which we have the best child care and pre-K system in the world. We can live in a country where everybody who has the ability and desire can get a higher education regardless of their income. We can live in a country where our seniors can retire with dignity and not have to choose between food and medicine. And that is why we have to expand Social Security, not cut it. We can live in a country where everybody, regardless of their race, their religion, their disability, or their sexual orientation, realizes the full promise of equality that is our birthright as Americans. Brothers and sisters, this is not utopian dreaming. This is the country we can create if we are prepared to stand together, if we are prepared to take on the billionaire class, if we are prepared to create a vibrant, powerful political movement. Thank you all very much.